Healthy Planet with Bob DiBenedetto next on Enviro Close-Up. Welcome to Enviro Close-Up. I am Carl Grossman. Healthy Planet on its website describes its mission as promoting food choices and lifestyles that respects our bodies and our shared environment, educating people about the deep connection among all life on Earth and the powerful effect our everyday choices can have on creating a cleaner, healthier, and more compassionate world. Bob is the president and the executive director of Healthy Planet. Bob, a focus of Healthy Planet is eating lower on the food chain and its benefits to the environment. Can you elaborate on that?
Sure. We focus on teaching people to eat lower on the food chain for many reasons, and they're related to our health and the environment. And when we're teaching people what we teach, we want to teach them the thing that's going to have the biggest bang for their actions. So if they're going to be taking an action that's better for their health, we want it to be a meaningful action, something that makes a big difference instead of impacting just a small part of our health while being perhaps bad for the rest of us. When we're talking about doing something that's good for the environment, we want them to do something that really impacts the environment in a big way. So while we teach about all of our choices and the impact that they have on our health and the environment, we focus a lot of our attention on the impact of choosing meat and dairy products versus eating more plant products, because it has such a big bang for the buck.
How does it have such a big bang for the buck?
Okay, well, it's a big story, and I mentioned it's a big picture item. I'll give you some examples. First of all, it all starts with the fact that when we're eating meat products, we're not just growing food and then taking that food and putting it into our mouths. We're growing food, we're feeding it to a middleman, and in this case, it's a cow or a chicken or a pig, and then we're killing that middleman and eating the food. So what happens in that process is we're taking about 6 to 16 pounds of grain, somewhere between there, feeding it to a cow, killing them, getting 1 pound of meat back in return. So if you'll do the simple math, you see that a lot of that food that is being fed to the animal is going somewhere. It's being wasted. It's going toward energy, and a lot of it is coming out of the other end. So therein lies the problem. We're taking in a huge amount of resources in the form of grains and feeding them to the animal. So much to the point that most of the lands that we use for agriculture in the United States is not growing food for people, but growing food for animals. And so when you take that much food and you feed it to animals, and then you've got so much waste coming out of the other end of the animal, you're creating a large problem with the pollution. So if you take just the water pollution that's involved, most of the water pollution in this country is coming from agriculture. Most of the agriculture in this country is animal agriculture. That is either raising grains for animals or having animals graze on the land. So you see that just water pollution alone is a very serious problem, and most of it is coming from animal agriculture.
This is not just a national problem, though. The United Nations issued a report recently, which you cite in your on your website.
Yeah, it was a 400-page report. It's called Livestock's Long Shadow. And that report looked at all aspects of livestock production. And they said that livestock production is one of the top two or three causes of all major environmental problems, from local to global. And their language is rather strong, and for a good reason, because 30% of the Earth's landmass is being grazed by animals, or it's raising food for animals. So there are an enormous number of impacts that come from our choice of animal products over our choice of plant foods.
How do you shift, well, back to the United States, this hamburger, hot dog eating society, how do you figure that you can get people to eat vegetables and tofu and so forth?
Well, that's the whole purpose of our organization, is to let people understand the implications of their choices. If you have two people, one understands what their choices produce in the world and the other has no clue, chances are this person's going to make different decisions than this person. both in the way of eating foods that are healthy for them and in the way of eating foods that are good for the environment. So our purpose is to have people become empowered by understanding the full implications of their choices. And by understanding things, we mean knowing that when they're picking up a burger, say, they can have the numbers that we're constantly teaching people about 2,500 gallons of water, 67 square feet of rainforest, the leading source of water pollution, the cause for 70% of the rainforest coming down, one of the leading uses of water in our country. And also let them understand that we've got starving people in this country and that the using all of our food to feed to animals doesn't make sense in that context. Another part of this equation that's really interesting to me is the fact that global warming is an issue that most people think is solely connected to the amount of fossil fuels that we're burning. But in fact, studies have been done that have shown, including the United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization report that I mentioned, that have shown that the amount of carbon that comes from automobiles and all forms of transportation combined is 13%. Compare that to the fact that livestock contributes 18% to our global warming gases. So it's 40% more than all forms of transportation combined. And when you look at that, you see that the solutions, the modifiable things that we can do in our lives that will remove our burden of carbon from the atmosphere and carbon equivalents are much more changeable by virtue of changing our diet than by changing the amount that we heat our homes or the amount that we run our air conditioning. Because really, we need heat in the winter, and we need to drive our cars a lot of the time. But we can change our diet very simply and very easily. I could go into a lot more into each one of those aspects, but we want people to kind of get it to the point where they're making a decision with all that in mind.
Global warming education and how global warming is not, you stress, a political issue. Elaborate on that.
Yeah, I find it kind of interesting and kind of sad and kind of amusing at the same time. Here we are in a world where the scientific consensus is really clear about global warming. They understand completely the human role in this. While the science is ever evolving, the science is really clear. So in the context of a world where we understand that the science is really clear, we have a world, the United States, which is divided in their understanding of the issue. And what has happened is the science was put out there and finally, it gains traction toward 2008. You had people like George Bush accepting the fact that global warming was actually caused by humans and that the human addition to global warming was very important. Mitt Romney stated it. Newt Gingrich did a commercial with Nancy Pelosi saying that we need to do something about global warming. And then all of a sudden, things started to change. And you had a political party identify themselves with taking a side on a scientific issue. And the political party was the Republican Party, and they decided that their side of that issue was to be stated as, we don't believe that humans are involved in global warming. Now, an opinion is great, a belief is great, but when it's dealing with a subject where it's an objective topic, like global warming, where the scientific consensus is clear, for to state a political belief as if it's a fact is very bizarre in this world. It's very strange. So that's what has happened over these years. So now we have a debate raging, which is a debate between science and belief. And how does belief get into a scientific debate?
How do you deal with the, well, it's a denial. The global warming deniers are out there. What's the strategy of Healthy Planet to educate people about global warming?
Well, it's basically to let them understand in any way we can to know that global warming is real by letting them hear from the experts exactly what the situation is. For instance, we've had interviewed NASA scientist Gavin Schmidt on the radio program, and he speaks at our events. He's coming to speak at an event of ours, and he is one of the lead scientists on global warming, and he is very clear and concise and rational in his explanation. And when you hear someone who is specifically involved in the primary research of this, he's a climatologist and climate modeler, you get it from his mouth, you start to understand that the people who are giving you information on the other side maybe don't know that much.
Now, how did you, Bob, get into this struggle for a healthy planet?
Well, I've been interested in this kind of my whole life. And in 1989, I did a retreat, and it was a three-month silent retreat where—
You didn't talk at all?
We didn't talk at all, no. And the only talking you'd do is every other day you'd have 10 minutes with a teacher, and you wouldn't talk about anything, you would just describe what was happening. It was instructional, so he or she would look to see what was happening with your experience and kind of guide you. So it was 3 months of silent retreat, sometimes 20 hours per day of meditation. So it was very intense. And in doing that, most people can't even understand what would happen if you spent that much time silent. But basically, in a nutshell, it enables you to go beyond who we think we are. And who we think we are is basically a collection of habits and conditioning and whatever happens to have happened to us in our lives between when we were born and now. And then we come out and say, here I am, I'm this. I believe that global warming doesn't exist. I like pizza. I do this, I do that. And all of these things have no solidity. They're not really who we are. And so coming out of this retreat, I had even a better understanding of that. And so that's important from this perspective, in that when we're choosing to do something in our lives that may have an impact both on our health, on the environment, understanding that the choices we've made in the past have nothing to do with the choices we make going forward, both individually and societally, is really important. And so here we are in a world where people are making choices based upon the person they think they are, and that is not solid. So I said, all right, it's not solid. We can go out there and really give people an understanding of how to choose something that's going to create both the bodies and the world that people really value, that they believe in. So it's not a matter of what happens if your father kicked you in your head when you were 3 years old, or you know, you're 5 years old, you were embarrassed in school. It's a matter of what we're looking to create. And there is a very clear path between our choices and the world that we're looking to create.
The pre-retreat Bob DiBenedetto, what was he about? And then what did you do after this epiphany through this retreat?
Well, I was very much the same prior to the retreat. I had been meditating for many years, and I was also teaching and practicing martial arts. So the Eastern culture and the Eastern wisdom was something that I was always interested in. However, 5 years prior to starting Healthy Planet, I was working on Wall Street, and I was involved in commodities trading. I was doing technical analysis of commodities charts. And I was, even during that time, though, I was waking up at 5 in the morning, meditating for an hour, going out for a run, and doing all kinds of things. I'd come into the office feeling great, and everyone would say, what's going on with that guy? So the meat was pretty much the same, but just filtered a little differently.
And then how did you make the transition? I mean, you do the retreat, and what was your next step?
Well, I actually got lucky. I was teaching martial arts at a school, and one of my students came to me, and he held a book up, which was called Diet for a New America, a book that was written by the son of the Baskin and Robbins. His name was John Robbins. And he says, have you read this book? And I said, I sure have. You know, it's because I had been eating a plant-based diet for many years by that time. And the book was all about the impact that our food choices have on our bodies and the world. And so he says, let's start one of these chapters. And so, in fact, we did that. We rallied up 10 or so people and created a chapter, and we started having big meetings, you know, hundreds of people coming together on a monthly basis. That was the beginning of it.
Healthy Planet, another major issue, has to do with energy. Yeah. You're based on Long Island. You've been crusading for this big island, 120 miles long, using safe, clean, renewable energy as opposed to
Right.
to dirty and dangerous energy. Describe that campaign.
First of all, the reason why we do it is because there are very few things in life that are win-wins. Usually we make a decision and we're kind of debating it. Well, is it really good because there's this factor over here, and is what's more important, this or that? In the area of energy, it's one of those areas, like in the area of food choices, that is a win-win. That is, if we choose clean energy, we not only win by getting a type of energy that enables us to be energy independent as a country, but we win because we get more jobs. And we win because we don't pollute the world as much. And we don't pollute the environment. We win because we don't suffer from the health problems that we suffer at because we're using all this fossil fuel. You know, we have millions of people that are suffering from diseases as the result of fossil fuel burning. Everything from asthma to emphysema, heart disease, cancers, birth defects, and tens of thousands of people who are sickened and die every year. So what is the rationale for that? Well, there isn't really any good rationale for that except for the fact that it's making somebody an awful lot of money. So what we're taking this issue and doing with it is saying, look, here's the issue as it lies. We have the alternative of going for efficiency and alternative energy, clean, renewable energy, or we can stay with the dirty fossil fuels. And in much the same way as we teach about diet, we say, if you choose this, these are the outcomes that get created in the world. If you choose the oil and the fossil fuels, these are the outcomes. What do you choose? Now, very often what we see is that fossil fuels are looked at as a cheap alternative. But that's not really true. They're looked at as a cheap alternative because initially the cost out front may seem cheap. Oh, but I'm only paying XYZ for oil, and wind power is going to cost me 2 cents more per kilowatt hour. And what we say is, you're not looking at the whole equation. Having studied economics in school, I know what a cost-benefit analysis is. And a cost-benefit analysis is basically looking at all the factors, figuring out the costs, and weighing those against the benefits, and then making a decision based upon the thing that has more benefits than costs. Well, in the cost-benefit analysis for fossil fuels, we look only at the upfront cost, that is the number of dollars we have to pay for natural gas or oil, when in fact, the external costs, the costs that we're not aware of, are much higher than what we're paying out front. And I'll give you a couple of examples of that. Terry Tamminen, who was the head of the EPA in California under Arnold Schwarzenegger, wrote a book called Lives Per Gallon. And he quantified the amounts of money that we're spending on these external costs related to fossil fuels. And here's what he came up with, that every year for every person in the United States, we're spending up to $2,700 on fossil fuels. Now, this isn't for the fuel itself. This is for the cost for the military, because the military has to protect all of our fossil fuel interests around the world. And even for transporting that to the United States, there is a high military cost involved. It's for the cost of all the diseases that I mentioned and paying that health cost. It's the cost to the environment. And there are so many costs that we're not aware of that are in this equation that if people understood, they would say, let's see, $2,700 per year on these subsidies or a few dollars extra on my bill every month to pay for clean energy. Clearly, the clean energy is what I'm going to choose.
Speaking of denial, there are those who say that you can't power our society with solar and wind and geothermal. What's your response?
Right. And they also said that we can't change what kids eat in schools. And there's naysayers all the time. We can do anything. It's easy. In fact, on Long Island, there was a study done, and elsewhere it's been looked at as well, and society is moving in this direction, parts of society, and I'll give a couple of examples. But on Long Island, a study was done, and they found that the cost of moving from where we currently are, burning mostly natural gas and other fossil fuels, to entirely existing for our electricity needs on renewables and efficiency was something that we could do by the year 2020 for all households. And the cost would not be major. In fact, it would be minor. It would be around the area of 10-12%. So when you look at that little extra cost, and you compare that to the amount of cost that I mentioned as far as what we spend on the external subsidies for fossil fuel, you see that it's really cheap. But not only that, the amount of fossil fuel that we use on Long Island and in other parts of the country, this was looked at in Massachusetts. They said, how much is created in the way of jobs when we use this fossil fuel that we import from another part of the country? And they found that if they do efficiency work, that is, add insulation, make your structures more sound, create a more efficient structure that isn't going to use as much fuel in the first place. When you do that, you're going to put about 10 people to work for every one person that would have worked if you continued to import fossil fuels from another part of the country. So it really makes so much sense in so many different ways.
Cancer and cancer prevention has also been a major issue. The health crisis that we're undergoing, the
right.
Epidemic of cancer. In fact, you've worked very closely, speaking of Huntington,
yes,
with another Huntington-based group, and the executive director of that, Karen Joy Miller, exactly, has been a couple of times on Enviro Close-Up. Prevention is the cure. The relationship between cancer and and pollution?
Well, it's a big topic. If you look at cancer overall, first of all, we have about 575,000 deaths per year from cancer. So it is a very big issue that impacts all of us. Do we have a healthcare crisis? No, we have a crisis of disease, of diseases that we're able to prevent. Now, why do I say that they're so preventable? Because we have, from the most mainstream of organizations, such as the National Cancer Institute, we have them saying that 50 to 75% of cancers are preventable via modifiable diet and lifestyle factors. 50 to 75%, that's huge, both in terms of cost and in terms of human toll. So regarding the environment and its cause on cancer, that is one of the less known areas of cancer prevention. I'll say a little bit about that, though. We have about 80,000 chemicals in society. Now, most people think, well, all of these chemicals must have been studied, when in fact, they have not been. Very few have been really studied in depth. And when they've studied them, even if they have really a good idea of what this chemical does, they rarely study what this chemical does when combined with this chemical. And so you could take something like tobacco. Tobacco, we know, causes problems if you smoke it. Asbestos, we know, causes problems when you're exposed to it. When you put the two together, it causes much more of a problem. Have they studied that? In most cases, no. Figure 80,000 chemicals. To put one together with the other and study all those interactions, it's virtually unexplored. Another example is the synthetic pyrethroids that they spray for West Nile virus. Those are something that kill mosquitoes, but when you mix those pyrethroids together with piperonal butoxide, which is a synergist, you just put one part of this piperonal butoxide with the synthetic pyrethroids, and all of a sudden, 10 times the effect is created on the mosquito, so it's 10 times more effective. Now, they're spraying this over our heads and for the West Nile virus, and this is a possible carcinogen, and this is a neurotoxin, but they're doing it nonetheless. So you take all these things, and we really don't know where we're going with this. However, with cancer, we do know, I mentioned the National Cancer Institute, there are many other organizations that have come out and said how preventable cancer is. If you look globally, 30% of cancer is looked at as being associated with the food that we eat. And so when we're eating the type of standard American diet that we're eating, it is the wrong diet. And so it's a matter of diet, exercise, not drinking a lot of alcohol, and not smoking. And if you put those factors together and maintaining your weight, which will come from doing the things that I mentioned, and when you put all that together, you see that it really is a very preventable disease. Now the question is, what do we do? I'm sitting here and I'd like to prevent 75% of cancer. What do all of the cancer organizations say? This is the interesting part. If we didn't know, you would understand people not doing anything in their lives to change it, but we do know. All of the cancer organizations say some variation of this: choose most of what you eat from plant sources. Now that goes right along with what's best for the environment. So most of what you eat from plant sources, and choose unprocessed foods. So that means eating the whole food, eating it as it came from the ground, as opposed to eating it in a processed state. Most people would want to prevent cancer in their lives, but if they don't understand the tie between cancer and diet, then they're not going to really be able to make choices that will lead them toward avoiding so much of the cancer, which we now know is avoidable. So what do most of the cancer organizations say? I could look at the American Institute for Cancer Research that has studied all of the studies out there on cancer, and they came up with guidelines. They say, as do many of the other cancer organizations, that we should be eating most of what we eat from plant sources in as unprocessed a state as possible. So we're not eating the burger on the white bun, we're eating plants with whole grains. It's a very different profile and a very different way of choosing foods. And it is beneficial to us, not just in preventing cancer, but that same diet is going to remove environmental pollutants from our environments and reduce cancer further, because so much of the environment is being polluted by all of the grains that we're growing for the animals. And all of that goes into the water and all of that goes into the air, and it creates sickness that we don't even know about.
How does Healthy Planet do its education, your programs?
Well, in a number of ways. First, we've been holding a very large, successful lecture series, dinner lecture series, eco cafe lecture series, for many years. And this is a matter of bringing experts in from around the country and around the world to speak authoritatively on topics that people want to know about. And when you hear a person live, it's different from hearing it on the news, because the person on the news, or you hear the sound bite, it doesn't tell you a whole lot. When you can sit down with an expert for an hour and hear what they have to say and then ask them questions, all of a sudden that becomes part of your context for deciding what you can do in your life and the power that you have to make a difference. So we run these dinner lectures and these lectures, and we've been doing that a long time. I also do a radio program, bringing these same experts to the sound waves, the airwaves on Long Island, as well as on the internet. And that's another way where, again, they're not listening to a commercial radio show where they hear 10 minutes and then it goes to 5 minutes of commercials. It's a non-commercial radio program.
And people could tune in on their computer to what? Yes, URL, what website?
It's WUSB is the radio station, but they can go to thehealthyplanet.org, thehealthyplanet.org, and that has the schedule of our radio programs that are upcoming. And it will tell them also, it'll have all of our archives for previous shows. So we do the dinner lectures, we do the radio program. I've also done something called a healthy school lunch program. I started this in Long Island in 1994. And that was a matter of going into schools and teaching kids what was best for them. First, going to nutrition committees and helping them start, and helping parents who were empowered to make a difference in their schools, coaching them through the process of changing their school lunches. And then actually doing presentations to kids, letting them know exactly the impact of their food choices on their health, and for the older kids on the environment. And we've done video showings and education of that sort. All kinds of programs that have been very much aimed at letting people know that what they're eating has an impact, and their food and lifestyle choices have an impact on the world. And also, something you mentioned earlier, I also work with county governments, with Karen Joy Miller, on letting people know through the Cancer Awareness Task Force the power of prevention. And through that, we've reached a lot of people as well.
It seems you're moving, or have moved, into a vacuum. I mean, you'd figure that government and schools and, you know, I mean, they should be doing what you've been doing, no?
Yes, and we were 20 years ahead of the pack. Now things are changing, though. You've all seen Michelle Obama come out and push for healthy school lunches. They've actually increased the amount of vegetables in school lunches precipitously in the last year. There's a national prevention strategy that's been formed, which is looking at how to prevent diseases, which is really new. You know, the government was way lagging behind on this. So government has been lagging behind, but also we work with a lot of other groups on various campaigns, both with nutrition. We're a member of the National Alliance for Nutrition and Activity. That's people all over the country pushing through the Center for Science in the Public Interest, pushing for scientific-based foods in the schools. And we also work with a lot of other groups educating about global warming, educating about climate change, advocating for clean, renewable energy. So it's not us alone. Now it's a broad group and of people that are working all toward creating something new. And it is effective.
Bob DiBenedetto, he is the president and executive director of Healthy Planet, which has been doing good, very good work. I'm Carl Grossman. This has been Enviro Close-Up. Thank you, Bob.
And very welcome.
Thank you for watching. To learn more about the Enviro Close-Up series of programs, go to our website at www.envirovideo.com.